Good morning, guys. Forge, July, end of July. Good to see you guys here, the spiritual remnant, as we gather together on a weekly basis. We're glad you're here. We're a group of men interested in becoming great men as God defines greatness, and we're going to talk about that today. I was talking to John Davis about what Presbyterians are, and he goes, you know what a Presbyterian, I'd never heard this one before. How come I never heard this? You know what a Presbyterian is? I go, no, what's a Presbyterian? He says, well, they're frankly Baptists who don't want to give up smoking and drinking and too poor to become Episcopalians. So I don't know who you are or what you are, but we're Christian men. We're here together, and we're in a series, Knowing Jesus. And because the reality is, the more we know Jesus, the more we are shaped into a manhood that is truly attractive. We pursue greatness that is truly greatness as God defines it. And today we're going to talk about getting clean and staying clean. Now, some of you guys smell really good this morning. In fact, my son actually took a shower this morning. He smelled and put, you got some great cologne on. You smell really good this morning. And but when you were kids, was that a value, being clean? No. For boys? No. We all have that in common, that being clean, looking clean, being clean was not a value. And I know that. That's one thing we have in common. Isn't it a great thing? I grew up in Southern California, and outside of L.A. in a new suburb. It was new back then. And there was a big field right next to our house. And it was an open, empty field, tumbleweeds, dirt. It was awesome. And my dad built a foxhole. He was a World War II vet. And so we liked to play army in the neighborhood. He says, you want a foxhole? I said, is the Pope Catholic? Of course, I didn't say that back then, but I said, yeah, I want a foxhole. He dug a foxhole right on the other side of this brick fence that he had built. Then our lawn was over here. And it was awesome because some guys built another fort out there about 75 yards away. And so we could play army, but the best thing was when we played army with rocks. That was the... I look back and I think, what an idiot I was. How many of you guys had rock fights when you were kids? Yeah, right. I was, guys, isn't that awesome? And so I was out there fulfilling my boyhood, getting dirty, and having rock fights. It was great. Now, but back then was the day when your Levi's were too long. What did you do? Do you remember? You rolled them up and you had cuffs. And so the problem is that when you're out playing in the dirt or the sandbox at school, but they had some great sand at school too. The problem was is that what happens into your cuffs? Filled them up, right? So some of you guys are knowing exactly where I'm coming on this. So I would come home and my mom would be like a defensive back and just you are not getting in this house until those cuffs get dumped, right? For some reason, she didn't like the dirt and all the scuzz on the carpet. I don't understand. I understand it now because I'm married, but it was great. It was not really a value. She didn't like gum on shirts and dirt and walls and stuff like that. But boys, little boys, we care less. It's awesome. We were not concerned with being clean. Now the reality is that even as we get older, there's a lot of guys that are not concerned with getting clean. Not being clean, but it's not physical dirt we're talking about, it's spiritual dirt. And so there's a lot of guys that are really, even as they get older, not concerned about being clean morally or spiritually. We're going to talk about that, but I love this story of this. Somebody sent me the story of this trial that took place in a small Mississippi town. You might have heard of this. The prosecuting attorney called to the stand his first witness, which was a grandmotherly, elderly woman from Mississippi. Called her to the stand. He approached her, and the prosecuting attorney said, Mrs. Jones, do you know me? She said, why, yes, I know you, Mr. Williams. I've known you since you were a boy, and frankly, you've been a big disappointment to me. You lie, cheat on your wife, and you manipulate people and talk about them behind their backs. You think you're a big shot when you haven't the brains to realize you'll never amount to anything more than a two-bit paper pusher. Yes, I know you. I love that. The lawyer was absolutely stunned, as you can imagine, because lawyers never usually ask questions unless they know the answers, and he wasn't expecting that. And so not knowing what to say, he looked over at the other, the defense attorney, said, Mrs. Jones, you know the defense attorney? And she went at it. Yeah, I do. I've known Mr. Bradley since he was a youngster, too. He's lazy, bigoted, and has a drinking problem. He can't build a normal relationship with anyone, and his law practice is one of the worst in the entire state. Not to mention he cheated on his wife with three different women. One of them was your wife. Yes, I know him. The defense attorney nearly died, and the judge made both those guys approach the bench, and he said, if either of you idiots ask her if she knows me, I will send you to the electric chair, man. I love that. So we were little boys. We're not concerned with getting physically clean, and sometimes as we grow up, we're not concerned with being morally clean either. In fact, some guys, when it comes to moral cleanness or spiritual cleanness, they're more afraid of getting caught than really getting cleaned up, right? Now, all of us knows people in those categories, right? Some of you have a sensitive conscience. Some of you don't have as sensitive a conscience. Some people are not concerned with moral dirt. In the text we're going to look at today in Mark 7, Jesus is dealing with a group of people who really weren't concerned for moral dirt. Well, they were, but they thought they could clean themselves up. So let me read the text, and then we'll talk about that and getting cleaned up. Mark 7, 1 through 23, here it is. Now, when the Pharisees gathered to him with some of the scribes who had come from Jerusalem, they saw that some of his disciples ate with hands that were defiled. That is, what? What's that word? Unwashed. And then Mark goes into a parenthesis here to show he's writing to Romans who need some explanation about what Israel was all about and what the Jews were all about, because he's writing to Romans. He says, for the Pharisees and all the Jews do not eat unless they wash their hands, holding to the tradition of the elders. And when they come from the marketplace, they do not eat unless they wash. And there were many other traditions that they observed, such as the washing of cups and pots and copper vessels and dining couches. And the Pharisees and the scribes asked him, why do your disciples not walk according to the tradition of the elders, but eat with defiled hands? And he said to them, well, did Isaiah prophesy of you hypocrites, as it is written? Jesus sounds here a little bit like that elderly lady there. Well, did Isaiah prophesy of you hypocrites, as it is written? This people honor me with their lips, but their what is far from me? Their heart is far from me. In vain do they worship me, teaching as doctrines the commandments of men. You leave the commandment of God and hold it to the tradition of men. And he said to them, you have a fine way of rejecting the commandment of God in order to establish your tradition. For Moses said, honor your father and mother, and whoever reviles father or mother must surely die. But you say, if a man tells his father or his mother, whatever you would have gained from me is korban, that is, given to God, then you no longer permit him to do anything for his father or mother, thus making void the word of God by your tradition that you have handed down. And many such things you do. And he called the people to him again, and he said, hear me, all of you, and understand. There is nothing outside a person that by going into him can defile him. But the things that come out of a person are what defile him. And when he'd entered the house and left the people, his disciples asked him about the parable. And he said to them, then are you also without understanding? Do you not see that whatever goes into a person from outside cannot defile him? Whatever goes into a person from outside cannot defile him, since it enters not his heart, but his stomach, and is expelled. Thus he declared all foods, what? Clean. And he said, what comes out of a person is what defiles him. For from within, out of the heart of man, comes evil thoughts, sexual immorality, theft, murder, adultery, coveting, wickedness, deceit, sensuality, envy, slander, pride, foolishness. All these evil things come from within, and they defile a person. Wow, that was a long text. But it does hang together, doesn't it? Let's talk about it. Because this text is dealing with something that's very important. There are three views. I want you to note. There are three views of this idea of cleansing, guilt and cleansing among people of all times. There are three views. And you see these people, these three types of views all the time. There's the materialist, the self-salvationist, and the Christian. When it comes to guilt, spiritual dirt, and how do you get clean? And some of you guys saying, wait a minute, I don't see any materialists in this text. You're right. Good observation. But there are three views of getting clean. The materialist, the self-salvationist, and the Christian. Let's talk about them real quick. The materialist is somebody you guys, we run into all the time. You say, what's a materialist? Well, I'll explain that. But the materialists are around us all the time. In Jesus' day in Israel, most people were either theists or polytheists. What's a theist, gentlemen? A theist is somebody who believes in a God. A monotheist is one who believes in one God. A polytheist is somebody who believes. Now, in Israel, what predominated? Polytheists or monotheists? Monotheists, right. Monotheists predominated in Israel. Why? Because Israel was the nation founded on the one true God of the Old Testament. But were there polytheists in Israel? Yeah, there were. There were Greeks and Romans, the gods of Olympus. And they had different names, whether it was a Greek name or Roman name, they're the same basic gods. So there were people in Israel that were but most people were theists, at least, of some sort. Were there any materialists? You say, well, you got to define a materialist. All right, a materialist is somebody who really doesn't believe that there's a God. It's not just that they're into material things. Are you guys into material things? I'm into material things. Some of us are recovering materialists in that we want to get more and more and more. So I'm a recovering Pharisee and a recovering materialist too. But in a philosophical sense, a materialist is somebody who doesn't believe there is a God. They believe that material things are all that existed. And so they believe that all material things just either happened spontaneously by chance, or that, well, they just eternally existed. So a materialist is somebody who really believes that all that is real is the material world. There is no God beyond it. There is no creator. All that is the material. Were there materialists in that day? Yeah? Yes, there were. How do I know? I know this. About 630 years before Jesus, the Greeks began a project called Greek philosophy. Now, they didn't sit down and say, hey, let's start coming up with new philosophies. No, but a lot of the Greeks by Jesus' time were tired of the gods and didn't believe them anymore. But what you need to understand is that 630 years before Jesus, at least, the Greek philosophers began to say, let's think about life out without reference to the Greek gods, to the gods. Let's think about life without the gods. And so they began to focus on human reasoning. And they began to try with a real faith in human reasoning to figure out life. And they defied life without God. So they were materialists in one way or another. A materialist thinks in the material world. Now, let me ask you this. If you're a materialist, what has that got to do with values, ethics, right and wrong, getting dirty morally? What's a materialist view of morality? Any ideas? Well, let me just suggest it, because it's early in the morning, and I've already pushed you a little bit, thinking-wise. A materialist who doesn't believe there's a God and believes that everything that is material, doesn't believe in any transcendent values. There's no morality. There's no right and wrong. Right and wrong is only decided by a particular culture or a particular group of people. So our materialists concerned about getting clean. Now, really, are any materialists have any moral base? Think before you answer. Some do. Are there guys that you know that don't believe there's a God who have a moral sense to them? Yeah. Yeah. They don't believe there's a God. They don't believe that God created the world. But there is a moral sense to them. But ultimately, what do they think about in getting clean morally, spiritually? I didn't do anything wrong. So why do I have to get clean? A materialist really is a person who doesn't think he's done anything wrong. And materialists don't see dirt in their cuffs and they got nothing to clean up. And so they're not particularly interested. Let me catch me on this. A materialist, in a biblical sense, can never become a great man as Jesus defines it, as the Bible defines it, because they can't pursue greatness in the way God defines it. Can a materialist become powerful? Can they have some fun in life? Yeah. Can they be kind of nice people? They can be. Can they also be horrible people? Sure. You know what's fascinating, and push somebody back on this sometimes. What's fascinating is the world tries to blame Christians for all the bad stuff that happens in the world. Christianity has caused more deaths, the Crusades, da 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 da. You know who's caused more deaths than anybody else? Atheists, for crying out loud. You know, the communist movement is a materialist movement. Nazism was a social engineering, no God kind of movement. It's important to understand that more people have been killed and have been abused through atheism and through materialism than through any kind of religions put together. So materialists are not concerned with getting cleaned up. You guys, where are you going with that? Let's go to the Pharisees real quick. Because the Pharisees were that next group. They were the self-salvationists. Now, self-salvation has come in different forms. Jesus is dealing with the Jewish self-salvationists. When I even say that word self-salvationist, what is that? What that almost defines itself for you. Do you catch what I'm saying here? Is that Jesus is dealing with people who thought, yeah, there's a moral standard, and yeah, I get dirt in my cuffs. Yeah, I get dirt spiritually in my heart, but what can I do about it? I can clean myself up. A self-salvationist, the Jewish self-salvationists were people who believed, yeah, there was a moral standard, and I get dirty, but I can clean myself up. And Jesus is dealing with the Pharisees, and I love that. In verse 1, it says that the Pharisees came from Jerusalem up to where Jesus was, and they gathered around him. Say you were at lunch today, and some of the most high-powered lawyers from Washington, D.C. just kind of came around your table, just showed up to wherever you were. You were at Four Rivers or wherever, just to mention a place. And they just gathered around you, and they just started questioning you about your beliefs, and they were intimidating. These guys were trying to intimidate. You know, they were not just asking Jesus a question here. They gathered around him to intimidate him. And by the way, Jesus wasn't scared. I love Jesus. I love to see him in the Gospels in certain situations with very intimidating people. He just is not intimidated. But they gathered around him, and they said to him, they noticed that the disciples of Jesus didn't always follow the rules and regulations that the Pharisees, in other words, they would eat meals unwashed. Now, guys, when you think about it, do you think the disciples ever got dirty physically? Are you kidding me? Their feet must have been atrocious. They wore sandals all the time and walked in dirt. And do you think their hands got dirty? Absolutely. They were scaggy a lot. I don't know what scaggy means. They were dirty a lot. And so this is not talking about washing your hands to get the dirt off your hands. What's it talking about? It's talking about ceremonial cleansing. In other words, the Jews had come up, these self-salvation, had come up with rules that were on top of God's rules to be clean before you ate a meal. So before you eat a meal, not only do you have to wash your hands and undo the cuffs, But you've got to do a ceremonial sort of cleansing. The word in verse 4, they come from the marketplace, they do not eat unless they wash. That's what said to the Pharisees. The word is baptizo. For you Baptists, you'll like that. It's the idea, but baptizo here doesn't mean they took a full immersion bath. We Presbyterians like the word because we know that baptizo can mean not only to dip and immerse, it can also mean to sprinkle. It has a semantic range, and I'll fight you on that if you want to, but that's not a big issue. And there are reasons why I'm a Presbyterian, you know, but it's probably because I don't have enough money to become an Episcopalian, for crying out loud. The Pharisees and the scribes say, why do your disciples not walk according to the tradition of the elders, but they eat with defiled hands? And Jesus doesn't play games. There are some people you don't play games with, and they're called hypocrites. Now, there are a lot of people who we need to be gentle with, caught up in sin like we are, but you don't have to, I have it on good authority, you do not have to be gentle with a hypocrite. You might want to retain your job, but according to Jesus, you can be straight out. Right? Rightly did Isaiah prophesy, you hypocrites. And a hypocrite in the Greek is what? Play actor. You guys are... This people honors me with their lips, but with their what? Their hearts. Their hearts are far from me. In vain do they worship me, teaching the doctrines... Teaching as doctrines the commandments of men. Self-salvationists not only believe that they can obey the law of God perfectly in order to undo their own sin, but that they can gain merit in order to earn God's favor. You catch that? The problem with a self-salvationist, however, is that they often go beyond God's laws and create man's laws. And this is the problem that we all have in every Christian denomination. We all have problems with this because we tend, even as Christians, to go beyond God's laws and create our own laws. What denominational distinctives do you have? I'm not asking for a raised hand here. What denominational distinctives do you have that go beyond Scripture? That when you're in your area, you got to follow those rules. You got to do that, or you'll get criticized, but they're not in the Bible. Let me give you one from mine. In my denomination, only elders can distribute the Lord's Supper. I mean ordained elders, ruling elders, and teaching elders, because we're more spiritual. But nowhere in the Bible does it say that. Does anybody know a place in the Bible where it says that only a ruling elder or a teaching elder can distribute communion? No. Do we go beyond Scripture in that point? Is it anti-Scripture? No. It's not. There's a good reason for it. But it's not essentially biblical. And so if somebody says, Pete, you are not spiritual, you're going to hell because you let somebody else distribute communion... That is a commandment of men. The Pharisees were experts at this, and we got to be careful. Now, it's interesting that the Pharisees went even a step further. They said in verses 9 through following here that you have a fine way of rejecting the commandment of God in order to establish your tradition. Moses said in the Ten Commandments, which commandment is it? Honor your father and mother. Anybody know which commandment? 1, 2, it's the fifth. The fifth, I see that hand back there. Wow, you get 3 free sins, both of you. You've already used up probably 2 of them on the way here, but that's pretty good. It is the fifth commandment, honor your father and mother, that it may go well with you and you receive the blessings of God. Rough translation. What did the Pharisees do? This is so cool. This is what the Pharisees did. They said, Dad, I know you want to use my weed eater, but I've dedicated it to God. Oh, no, that's what my son said to me the other... No. I know you want to use my weed eater, but I've dedicated it to God. Therefore, I can't give it to you to use. It's God's. I know that I have extra money in my bank account, but God, I've dedicated it to God. Dad, I can't loan any of that money to you. I know you're hungry, but that whole pantry has been dedicated to God, and I can't give anything to you. Isn't that fascinating? Self-salvationists not only think they've obeyed all of God's laws and done enough to work off their own sin, but then they come up with laws that are man-made and then impose them on other people. That's why, can self-salvationists become really great men? No, absolutely not. Why? Because it's all external. And they're dinking with the laws of God. Not only are they really not fulfilling all the laws of God, but they're creating other laws for other people. They're becoming mean and nasty. I love the cartoon a friend gave me. A man is standing before the gate of heaven, and he's trying to get in, whoever it is behind the podium there, you know, Peter or whoever. By the way, does it ever say in the New Testament that Peter is the one who regulates the gates? No, no, but there's biblical basis for that. Anyway, somebody's behind the podium. He looks at this guy's name for it in the Book of Life, and he says, yes, you were a believer, but you skipped the not being a jerk about it part. The Pharisees weren't believers, and they were jerks. And we can be that way too if we're into being self-righteous for salvation, because we think it's Jesus and what we do. Now, there's only one other group of people then that Jesus deals with, and he doesn't even really deal with them directly right here. It's the Christian. When it comes to getting dirty and guilty and getting clean, he's dealing with us, and that's what he deals with in the last section. He calls the people to him, and he says, there is nothing outside a man that can defile him. So where does defiling, guys, where does true moral dirt come from? From not washing your hands before you eat a meal? Comes from the heart. Comes from the heart. And so the Jews had all these regulations about what foods they could eat, right? Why did God give the Jews all these food regulations? Do not eat this. Do not eat shellfish. Da-da-da-da. Why not? Could be health. I mean, I had a meal with some friends the other day. We had lobster. It's great. I didn't get sick. But I'm going to hell. God bless you. Yeah. Yeah. Thank you, brother. Why did God give these regulations to the Jews? They might have been some of them health regulations, but mostly because they were to be a peculiar people. They were called out of Egypt by grace. It wasn't that they were good. God rescued them by grace. And then he gave them these rules. You're to be a peculiar people. You're to live this way, to not do these things and to do these other things, because I want the nations to come by you and to understand who the true God is. So some of those regulations, now here we see that all foods were considered clean now. Jesus says it's not about food. And that's why the Pharisees hated him, by the way, because Jesus messed up their self-salvation project. He came in and he says, not about self-salvation. You guys don't know what you're talking about. He says, because defilement comes from within and works its way out. And so man-made laws don't help us fulfill God's laws. The gospel, the good news, the great news, the radical reformation of Jesus is that he comes to us and he says, you are all a mess spiritually. You're dirty and you can't clean yourself up. Who can reach into our hearts and take out all the bad stuff? Can't do it. And that's why Paul in Ephesians 2:1 says, you're dead in your trespasses and sin. Before you came to Christ, you're dead, spiritually dead. I have never seen a dead man get up and walk. You have no ability to make yourself alive. You're defiled. You're dirty. That's bad news, right, gentlemen? The good news is that Christ comes along into our life. And in John 3, we see the reality is that he describes the Holy Spirit as the one who comes into a person's life. You can't see him, but you see the effects, you feel the effects, and before you know it, you're transformed and you're drawn to Christ. Some of you guys were pretty dirty before you came to Christ. How many of us were dirty before we came to Christ? That's 100%. How many of you, don't raise your hand on this one. We're going to pan the camera. No, no. Don't raise your hand. How many of you were really dirty? I said don't raise your hand. But I see that hand. I see that hand. I want to talk to you all. I want your stories. And could we change ourselves? No. Could we get to greatness by ourselves? No, we can't. And so that's why the New Testament clarifies that in the work of Christ, in the death, burial, and resurrection of Christ, in the life of Christ, he fulfills the law for us. Theologians call that the active obedience of Christ. In the death, burial, and resurrection, he paid for our sin, took our curse, and overcame the effects of death. Theologians call that the passive work of Christ. And that's how we get transformed when God comes to us and says, I am going to clean you from the inside out. That's how men become clean, through faith in Christ and Christ alone. That's where the shame is removed. That's where the guilt is removed. You say, well, don't I need to do anything? What do I contribute to my salvation? Here's what you contribute to your salvation: your sin. That Jesus comes along and makes you alive and makes me alive. That's the path to true greatness. Because greatness is from the inside out, and it's a work of God. It's a work of God, and it's so absolutely amazing that the reality is that a materialist can never become great because he can never get God's truth and power in him through trying to figure out life by himself. The self-salvationist can never become really a truly great person because he thinks, and he's deluded, that he's great by what he externally does. But the Christian man is a man who knows that he doesn't have what it takes, but that Jesus does. And that when he receives Christ, the Spirit comes inside and begins to bear fruit in him and through him, the fruit of the Spirit. Here's greatness: love, joy, peace, patience, goodness, kindness, gentleness. Against such thing and more, it's Christ in you, the hope of glory. So greatness is not how much money is in my wallet or in my bank account. It's not in the titles that I have. It's not in what we manage to work up externally. It's what Christ builds in us and through us. Now, some of you think I've committed great heresy today. Good. Talk about it around the table, and we'll get you out of here on time today. So I'm sure, I wish I could have been at every table to hear what you guys talked about today. So no, you don't want to know what's going on around our table. So Kevin up here says, I really kind of went through all three of these phases. I was a materialist, and then I kind of moved into the self-salvationist, and then I became a Christian. You know, that often is a logical procession of how God brings people to himself. There's no God, and then you get to a point where you realize that there's so much design and so much power in the world that you lose your faith in materialism. You lose your faith in the fact that all this just happened by chance. So then you say, well, there is a God, so I can be good enough. And then you realize after you try to follow, how many of us following Christ long enough, you say, I can't do this. I'm not good enough. Yeah, we can't do it. And you eventually, God brings us to our knees. Isn't that a wonderful place to be? Where we realize that we can't do that. Another brother up here said, isn't materialism the same thing as atheism? Answer? Yeah, it includes agnosticism too. Atheism is the positive statement there is no God, which is unprovable. Agnosticism is I don't think there's enough evidence to prove there's a God. That's just a weenie way out. I'm not going to do the hard intellectual work of trying to figure out if there's a God or not. There's plenty of evidence to make a decision. An agnostic says, as somebody up here said, I'm blissfully happy with just not believing. This is great. But then the Christian gets to the point where he says, gosh, am I ever going to get perfect? Are we ever going to get there? Are we ever going to arrive? Now think about this before you answer it. Yes. When will that be? Chet says, when we die. Let me put it a little more spiritual. 1 John 3:2 says, when we see him, we'll be... Chet went, yeah, when I croak. Yeah, but when I see him, then I will be like him, for I'll see him as he is. Will you ever arrive? Yeah, until then... We keep following Jesus because what grace does is it keeps working from the inside out, doesn't it? Keeps developing us. I've been following Jesus a long time. I'm a lot better than I used to be. I'm a lot better than some of you guys. And I still see so much sin in myself. You see, the closer you get to the light, the more you see your dirt. It's amazing. But yeah, I'm less uptight about my dirt than ever. And the reason? Grace. So with Fenelon, I say, you know, when I see it, I see the dirt, I confess it, and I move on. You don't have to agonize over your dirt because Jesus has paid for it, and he continues to develop. Isn't that great that he never gives up on us? I love that. I hesitate to end with this story. It's kind of R-rated. But this isn't a church, so here it is. Two guys are in a public restroom, and after using the facilities, one of them washes his hands and one of them doesn't. On the way out, the one who washed his hands says to the one who didn't, "When I was young, we were taught to wash our hands after going to the bathroom." The other guy says, "When I was young, we were taught not to go to the bathroom on our hands." Bobby, you can't use this on Sunday morning. The first guy is the arrogant guy, the self-salvationist. He thinks he can clean himself up. The second guy is the arrogant man. He's the materialist. He doesn't think he needs to be washed. The Christian knows he's dirty and runs to Jesus for the rest of his life. And the great progress continues. So that by the time we see him, we really are a lot more clean than we think because of his grace. And I hope you go out of here letting him continue to develop you because of his grace. Jerry lost his brother, and I'm going to pray for you as we end this time today. We go out through the phases of life, and I'm so thankful that you know Christ and that you're a great example for us as men, following Jesus, even through the challenges and losses of life. Let's pray together. Father, thank you for your goodness. Thank you that you continue to develop us when we lose our jobs, when we sin, when we lose loved ones. Be with Jerry, his family, I pray. I pray that you would be with us today, that as your sons, we would go out greatly confident in the all-sufficient work of Jesus Christ. And Jesus, it's in your name that we pray. In your strong and powerful and cleansing name we pray. Amen. Guys, have a great rest of the week.